So the discussion, well, this series was designed as a way to get us through, like, certain questions. And since it's a small forum, we'll make it less formal for the small forum. And certain things that happen during days of our lives, you know. And we'll be talking about birth, circumcision, and naming, and answering some deeper questions and some practical laws when it comes to that as well. We're talking about bar mitzvah and bat mitzvah, and we'll be finishing off doing a little bit of education, because we Jews like to learn. What are some of the Jewish ideas and thoughts on that? And we'll be finishing off, God willing, discussing a topic of death and mourning, which sounds a little depressing, but actually is pretty fascinating. And there's many, many, mostly customs, and many of them have quite interesting sources to them when it comes to that as well. So that's pretty much what we'll be working on over the next number of weeks. Okay? So tonight we'll begin at the beginning. And it begins with dating. But that's not tonight's topic. We're going to assume that you've managed to navigate the insane world of Manhattan dating. And you survived. And you were able to get pregnant. Okay? And actually, is that a mitzvah? What actually is the mitzvah? What is the mitzvah over here? What's the obligation? What are we trying to go for over here? What do you think? Is getting married? Is it?
Getting married.
So that's the miracle.
Is the mitzvah creating life?
So actually, interestingly enough, getting married is not the topic I speak about a lot. Is actually, interestingly enough, for a woman. It's a mitzvah for the man. Okay? It's still a great deed. But the answer to this, and this is actually a bigger question, which is going to come up a number of times, people see mitzvahs as good deeds, but they're not. Sometimes they are, sometimes they're not. But you can't just define it as a good deed, because mitzvahs are there to help us achieve what we need to achieve. And there's no mitzvah to breathe or to drink or to eat, because they're just like, obvious, I got to eat. So the Torah commands us to do things where maybe there's a natural inclination not to do it. So therefore, the proverbial gun is pointed at the guy, especially when it comes to dating and marriage, and he's the one who has to get married, and according to that, actually, having children is also just a mitzvah for the man. Now, the woman gets tremendous merit, obviously, but it's almost like a natural thing that women will want to have kids, and maybe men will not have that desire. Added to that is that giving birth is actually dangerous and very, very painful. And the Torah would never command a woman to do something which would put her life in jeopardy. So while it's a wonderful thing, but it's not really like, you got to do it right now, as it were. Okay? Having said that, unless things change, a guy's going to need a fantastic girl in order to actually have kids. And bringing up kids and having children is a big mitzvah. We're just saying the obligation is more pointed at the man, because women have the natural inclination, I hope they still have that, that was 2012, to get married one day and to have kids. And let me be very clear when I say this. There is no greater thing that two humans can do than to bring life into this world. Okay? And actually, I say humans because happens to be that it's actually, that sounds unusual, but a mitzvah for non-Jews as well to have kids, just to inhabit and to make this world. So this is unusual. I always found this very puzzling because, well, that's just basically to have kids. The whole point of life is like we have kids and then we die and they have kids and just keep going on and on. So the answer to this came to me from a story I heard from a friend of mine. May I mention before, I said again, though, if you haven't heard it. And a friend of mine was on a plane. And he was flying to, I think, to Israel. And he had a few kids on board. And there were different seats dotted around the cabin. And the kids kept coming over to him, you know, asking for this. This guy sitting next to him thought he had like 45 kids, you know, because, you know, they all look the same. So, and the guys, I think, you know, you start talking on planes to people you never normally talk to, you know. So they were talking. And this guy sitting next to my friend said, oh, I see you have lots of kids. Yeah, thank God. And he says, my wife and I don't have any kids. He goes, would you like to know why? So my friend was like, well, if you want to tell me, you know. So he said, I'll tell you why. Because we feel that having kids is an immoral thing to do. Why? Because this is a very cruel world. It's a difficult world, a challenging world. Who are we to bring a child into this world full of wars and famines and a lot of challenges. And my friend, that's a very fair point, actually, if you think about it. And my friend responded with a very brilliant answer, which is based upon Chinuch, actually, one of the sources we'll be looking at. And he actually says, you're right, I hear that, but we have kids because we're going to make that world into a better place. So we don't just have kids, right, like, you know, like various animals just to fill. We have kids because we want them to become model citizens who can actually make this harsh, dark, and difficult world into a better place. See, that's really the goal. And if you look at the early part of the Torah, all the stories that come from the Torah, it moves very quickly from the story of creation, which just takes a few pages, right? Which I thought, creation of the world, the universe, and everything, and moves speedily into the realm of building up a family. And the challenges that come with that, of marriage, and not having children, and having children, all that is major part of the conversation that leads you from page 3, pretty much right through the entire Torah, and really right through Jewish history. So that's our starting point. That's really our goal, you know? And we Jews, it's nothing to be ashamed of. As a side point, I will mention that contraception, various forms of it, unlike other religions, people always confuse us, you know, with other religions, is permissible. And actually, it is the various forms of it, not all of them. It's actually the woman who makes the decision. I am blessed with a number of children. My wife also had a miscarriage along the way, which, I mean, it was never easy. But in families with a lot of kids, it's like standard fare, really, because I think one in every four works out to be a miscarriage. So, especially in, you know, Jewish families where they have a lot of kids, it's like, and each time we have a child, we would approach my rabbi, a person I go to for advice, and we would say, well, we need to take a break. I mean, everyone's different, you see. And the rabbi would say, and he wouldn't say to me, oh, how do you feel about it? He would say to my wife, actually the question he asked my wife was, are you very, very tired, you see? And she'd just given birth, you know, and she's like, well, not, you know, a number of months ago. And she'd be like, always. Even after I wake up, you see, and they'll be fine. So I don't want you to. I just want to make a separation because we hear from these other religions. We hear a lot on TV and on the internet. We do about them, but it's actually the woman's decision. Okay. Now there is a mitzvah. Do you know how many kids a person's obligated to have, if they're able to have kids? How many kids they're able to have? So the mitzvah is to have two, one of each. Right. I like to say have three, one of each, but it doesn't work. So have two. One of each is the kind of goal. Some say you actually fill it with two, but because you want to keep bringing one male, one female, so you can keep the species going is actually the obligation, and that's really if a person's not able to have kids, they are not obligated, according to Jewish thought, to adopt or to use any of this IVF stuff. If they want to, it's a tremendous mitzvah, but they don't have to. Because once again, the Torah's not to obligate you to put your body, but if you want to do it, I happen to know many families that couldn't have children. And one of them I know, I used to live relatively near him, actually adopted Down syndrome children. About five of them. Right? Now, believe me, that's an obligation. Most people cannot do that, you know. But having kids is, I will mention over here as well, since it's a small group and intimate, Hi, that's okay, man. Nice to see you. I will talk just for a moment about abortion, just to show the Jewish view, because the Jewish view doesn't get too much press. It seems to put out the Christian view, and everyone thinks, well, that must be the Jewish view. So in Judaism, as I said, having life is a very important thing, but the mother's life takes precedence. And when I say the mother's life, it could be her physical life, or her mental life. So having an abortion in Judaism is not seen as a good thing. If, however, you can show that it's going to have physical repercussions upon the woman, right, that it could threaten her life, there's not a question. Until the baby starts to crown, at that point, he has as much, or she has as much right to life as the mother, interestingly enough, right? But up to that point, right, which happens, right, that point, the woman, the mother's life takes precedence. Earlier on, the better. There's certain cutoff points much earlier in the pregnancy, up to 40 days, for example, conception is much, much less. If I know cases where women get diagnosed with children get certain diseases, and the idea of the woman having such a child would completely, in her mind, ruin her life, and she becomes to the verge of suicidal, the thought of even having such a child, then having an abortion which should be permitted earlier on for sure is a... So I'm just saying it's not a blanket no, right? Having said that, I know a girl who got pregnant, and she was very, very young, and she just didn't want the baby, she wanted to abort it. And I got involved, and I actually got a... I don't want to speak to her. A woman I had to speak to, if it was better. So I had a very great representative here in the city. Her name is Leah Conn, who one day I'll hopefully bring along. She's a very brilliant woman. You know that? You met her. I had a conversation with her. She spoke to her. And the idea of, you know, having a baby and giving up for adoption, there's many Jewish families, many other families who would be very happy to... That seems to be... You try to lean the person towards... towards that. I just want to point, it's a much bigger area, I just want to point out that it's not so much the Christians, whereas there are times and circumstances when it would be permitted. There is no blanket acceptance, but there are times and circumstances when it would be permitted to do it. Okay? Having life is the most important thing. I've mentioned this before. Life is like the most important thing in Judaism. Right? I told you the five L's of my thought. I told you about language, Hebrew, law, Torah, land, Israel, love, and life. Lawrence, yeah. I've got to write that book. I keep saying it. So life is very important. I mean it very sincerely. To such a degree that you can break pretty much every law in order to save a life. Okay? When a woman is pregnant, saving that woman's life when she's pregnant and when she's in labor is considered she's in a life-threatening situation. Which means if a woman needs to give birth on Shabbat and people are Sabbath observant, it's called pikuach nefesh as a life-threatening thing. And you don't say around to her, because I'm a Sabbath observant Jew, you see. And we're like, oh, could you just hold in another, like, 3 hours? Sunless, it's getting closer. No. You get in a car, okay, and you take her there. Okay, that is a mitzvah. Actually, I'll tell you an interesting halacha, law. If a hospital doctor needs to be called, and there's a room of people, and you have a rabbi there, and a bunch of Jews who don't keep the Sabbath, for example, it's actually the rabbi's mitzvah to make the phone call. To show how saving a life is the most important thing. Talk about the life of the mother and the baby. Just talk about normal, regular delivery, right? It's very precious. Two of my daughters had the chutzpah, I'm joking, being born around Shabbat. And we had to get to the hospital. You don't ask questions. You just go. Okay?
What about if it's a doctor who is observant of Sabbath?
Yes.
He needs to deliver.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, of course. Yeah, absolutely. My doctor, my wife's doctor, actually. Well, the first one we used was a lady, Dr. Waltner, and she actually converted to Judaism. And then we changed to another one called Dr. Tannenbaum, is his name. And he is a very observant Jew. He's my wife's, and we used him for the last 3 kids. He's actually a very holy man. I mean, it's going to sound weird to you. He's a brilliant doctor, and he's used right through the community. They use many doctors. He actually prays for the mother in between contractions. He's a very... So he has the same obligation, right? If he is there, he's got to get to the hospital to deliver the baby. There's not much point me being there if my doctor's not going to be there. But let's say there are other doctors there, and she wants that doctor, she can bring on that doctor. Or we want that particular doula to be there, you know, because we use it for the first couple of babies, and then, you know. Absolutely. What the woman needs is... And even after birth, by the way. These laws, I'm telling you, actually go 3 days after birth. Okay, that anyone can do whatever they need. The woman's, because after three days, it's still considered to be life-threatening for the mother. Okay, so that's fine. So now you've had your baby. Now, there's 2 choices. You could have had a boy, or you could be disappointed. I'm joking, right? You could have a boy. I'm only kidding. You don't know me yet. I'm only kidding. I'm sorry. I'm joking. Okay. So you could have a boy, you could have a girl. Okay, so I always am. It's a reincarnation thing. In my last life, I did something to women, and now they're... Something. Speak to my wife about it. She knows all the details. Okay, so what do you do at that point? So, always make sure the baby is healthy and the rest of it, but you got to name the child. Actually, there's blessings that are made, actually, on the birth of a baby. So you make a blessing as soon as you're able to, out of gratitude, and now you have to name the child. So let's start with a girl, because that's slightly easier. So the different customs when to name a girl, okay? And the custom go from the first time the father goes to the synagogue. Okay, I'm talking about it from Jewish law, and then we'll discuss people who don't do this, which could be a Monday or a Thursday, because you read the Torah. When the Torah is read, the husband will go up and will name the child, and it's a big mazel tov, okay? That can happen on a Monday or a Thursday or a Saturday. Some wait to the first Saturday, so everyone's in the synagogue, and some actually wait 30 days. I think the Hasidim do 30 days, because by 30 days, you know, the child is going to be a viable baby, so that's when the baby is named. So the father usually goes up, goes to the synagogue, or gets someone else to do it for them, if they don't really go, and will name the child, and calls that child by their name. If you don't do that, whatever name you give your child becomes the name. Okay. Now, let's talk about naming in general. Names are very important. I don't mean your English name is fairly irrelevant. I mean, it's nice to have a nice name, you know. According to Jewish law, you shouldn't give a child a name that's going to embarrass them, by the way. You know, like call them like, you know, Moonbeam, you know. Or, what's the thing? I have a few teachers that come here. They have like twins in class, Male and Female, male and female. You hear this kind of thing, right? And there's a lot of this kind of stuff going on. That's not a good idea. You give a child a nice name. But the Hebrew name is the real name. So the Arizal, who was a great Kabbalist who lived in Sfat about 400-500 years ago, he actually says that we don't have prophecy nowadays. Disappeared from the Jewish people. As I always say, we're no longer a prophet organization, you know. But when it comes to naming a child, the parents are granted prophecy. Or maybe a slightly lower level called Ruach HaKodesh, which is a Holy Spirit that comes through them. So why is that necessary? Well, because the Hebrew name you give a child really defines its essence. And the Hebrew word for a soul is a neshama. And the middle letters are shem, which means name. So your name is really who you are. See? And you've got to be careful the name you choose. Now, there's different customs who people name after. And it usually goes like this in priority. First of all, people look to a grandparent, a name after them. Okay? If you're Ashkenazic, a deceased grandparent. If you're Sephardic, after a living grandparent. Okay? Of the baby, as in the parents, the mother's mother or father or that. And by the way, different customs, who gets the name first? In many families, it comes up a bit of an argument. Really, it should go with a woman first, I believe. Most families do that. Okay? So that's the first way to do it. You choose a name. And then you've got to check that name. I know it sounds unusual, but you want to make sure it's a good name. There's a guy who I know who actually was very involved here at the JC, as was his wife. And she was actually on the first ever Bat Mitzvah program I did over here and ended up doing their wedding. And so his name... was Omri. Now, sounds like a very beautiful name, and it's a name you see many times in the in scriptures. But when we married him, we had to change his name, because actually the name of a bad king, he's by the way the sweetest, loveliest guy, by the way, of the Jewish people. So the rabbi, one of the big rabbis who was there, head of yeshiva, happened to fly and said, you've got to change that name. That's not a good name, see? The name's very, very careful, you see. You've got to be very careful the name you use. You can't just choose anything. There's this Israeli habit of naming their sons Nimrod. Now, Nimrod is a character from the Torah who, if you look in the scripture, in the Torah itself, in the Bible, it calls him a Ish Tzayid Gibor, a strong man. So a lot of Israelis like that name. Actually, he was a dictator and a terrible person. Right? He tried to kill Abraham, right? So you don't get much worse than that. I always make a joke, if you get one kid Nimrod, call another kid, you know, Pharaoh and Achashverosh, you see? It's like, just go the whole way, you see? And then Jezebel, you see? You just don't want to, you don't want to go with them. So we changed his name, and you have to check and make sure that it's a good name. So the first thing people do to name children is name after grandparents. It's actually the right thing to do, okay? Happens to be, this is a little bit of a Kabbalistic thing, and I saw reference in a Ramban, one of the earlier commentators, he actually says that, if you're naming someone, you're actually taking that person's neshama and passing it down. It kind of stays in the family, you see. And it could be a little bit of reincarnation happening over here as well, says the Ramban. And uses certain cases from the Torah, particularly the story of Ruth and Boaz, where they actually came and he took, married her in order to bring a child from a brother and use a different name, and actually brought the kid back into this world. There is such discussions in the deeper sources. Maybe yes, maybe no. So there is this idea. So what else can you name a child? So some people name sometimes around the time of year. If you're born near a Jewish holiday, like boys born around Passover time would be called, in Hebrew? Nisan, right. Yes, very good. Yeah, Nisan. That's the month that Passover falls in. Moshe, how was that? Miriam, she was very involved in the Exodus from Egypt. People born around Purim time, which is about 30 days before Passover, could be called
Esther,
if they're a girl, right? Ideally. And Mordechai, if they're a boy, you see. Or Daniel. Daniel was actually involved in that story in a secret way as well. People born around Hanukkah time, right? They're called Yehudit. She's one of the heroines of the story, Yehudit. Or they get called Matisyahu, and they become rap singers, you know. So it kind of like depends where you're born. So it could be the... Also the Torah portion. The Torah portion a child is born in also reflects what's going on in the world. Maybe we'll choose a name from that as well. And they'll look through. Or finally, they'll just choose a name they like, which is, you know, fair enough, or a friend's name. Or finally, you're like my wife, and she has dreams, and the names are revealed to her in dreams. Such is my wife with every child. I'll tell you one quick story, if you don't mind. And this is actually pertinent. My wife was pregnant with our second child, and she said to me, it's a girl. See, I said, don't be silly. Why should I not know? And she said, I had a dream, I have the name. So I asked her, well, what name? She goes, I can't tell you yet. Okay, fine. So, humor. And then she gives birth. I said, what's the name? She goes, the name is Chaviva. I'm like, I've never heard the name before in my entire life. Where do you have such a name from? She goes, that's the name. I'm like, but can we talk about it? She goes, we can talk about it, but that's the name. Came to a dream, that's the name. So, I called my Rav, and I said to him, you know, it's a very unusual name. And he said, look, because I've never heard it before, it's a very weird name, I haven't heard it before. But first we have to make sure you don't choose a name that's going to embarrass people. So call various teachers of various schools in the area, see if that name occurs, number one. He says, don't argue over it, which is exactly what we did. And then he says, ideally, if your wife really, really wants it, then you should kind of go for it. But make sure the first two rules are copied over there. Okay, so that we were going to name on the Shabbat, which is the custom of my family. So it's Friday night, I'm at the table, my wife says, that, and I'm like, can we choose another name? Sarah? Rachel? I mean, Rachel really used, actually. But could we use some other names? She said, my wife was like, well, no. So for some reason, I don't know why, I pulled off the Torah, the Chumash, from the shelf, and I learned through the Torah portion with a translation, Aramaic translation, which is actually a mitzvah to do. Not for now, but so. And I read through, and I see that it tells a story of Judah and Joseph. You know, Yehuda, Joseph, and having a fight there in Egypt, and about to reveal himself in the brothers, you know. And he says, he used the word, his soul was connected to his soul, in the Hebrew, nefesh k'shuv nefesh, and translated as chaviva. It appears over there. So I called my rabbi, and he says, funny you called me, because, so we use that name, and I called him Saturday night, and he said, funny you call me, because I opened up the Talmud right afterwards, and the first thing that came to me was Rabbi Chaviva, and he doesn't appear too often in the Talmud. Then I spoke to another rabbi, and my baby was born on Hanukkah, and Hanukkah is the only mitzvah the Rambam describes as Chaviva Admod, very, very special. Chaviva means very, very special. So, we don't know. I had a friend of mine who was at a bris milah, and his wife had chosen name, as did he, and he was about to name the child at the bris milah for a boy. That's when the boy gets named at the bris, at the circumcision. We'll together in a second. And he's about to name. They say, what's the name is? And they turn around to the husband and say, what's the name? And you tell the guy who's naming the child, the rabbi or the friend, whoever who's doing it. So that's the custom way to do it. So he turns around to my friend. He's like, one second. He walks over to his wife, right, who's on the outside, and they huddle. And he comes back, and then he whispers the name, and they name the child. At this bris milah ceremony, you know. This is after the circumcision. Once the baby's become, you know, circumcised and Jewish, you give the name. So, afterwards, I approached my friend. I said, what was that? He goes, that thing weird happened. I was about to name the baby, and I just felt it wasn't the right name. So I approached my wife, and I said, I go, that's not the name. She goes, yeah, you're right. And I said, I think this is the name. And she went, you're right, that's the name. And like that, they changed the name. Isn't that crazy? It's a true story. I have my friend Chaim David.
What do you put on the birth certificate when you go?
That's a very good question. That's a very good question. My wife chose an English name. It's not a birth certificate. I think you have to fill out the form. I think people would generally, at that point, know the name and write it down. Yeah.
But you don't say it until the
You shouldn't really. It shouldn't be announced. Why? No. You can ask various people. They say it's not good muzzle to do such a thing, you know?
To even refer, like, as if you're talking to the baby?
Yeah. It's like, it. No, we don't. Like, so those first 8 days, or for the first girl, first, they don't. The first was the Tinoka-Tinokas. They don't refer.
Between you and your wife?
Right.
You don't really... I'm trying to remember now. One second. It's like... They all look like E.T. anyway. Just call it E.T.
Well, and if Hasidics do it for 30 days for a girl, you don't get a name for 30 days?
Just got to ignore the baby for 30 days.
Yeah.
It's
a long time.
It's like, who's that girl? I don't know. Don't look at her. yeah. I guess. I never thought of it. I guess you're right.
I know my mom couldn't figure out a name for my brother until like 3 days, and I guess she just didn't like, pick it before. I don't know. They were like threatening to like put like baby boy.
Now you're telling me it sounds a bit weird, but it's not very strange. For some reason, it's just like it just works out.
And my cousins have called their kids like the baby for that week.
Yeah. If you need to ask someone if that's a good name or not, you can, you know, choose a name, and you should really ask.
But you can write it down.
No, you can say it to someone. If you're asking a rabbi, I want to use this name, he'll tell you whether you can or cannot do that. That's fine. Okay? So the girl is named Torah. By the way, if you don't, you should have a Hebrew name. In order to have, if you don't get called up, just the baby should be known by that name a number of times, or a person ought to change a person's name. So if you have a Hebrew name, you call it a number of times, that's what it's called. I fill out ketubas, which is the only other time it's going to become relevant to fill out a ketubah, marriage document. And many times they say you have a Hebrew name, because I don't know my Hebrew name. I think it's this, think it's that. So we'll put the name in English. In Hebrew letters, right? So for Kaylee, for example, I put Kuf, Yud, Yud, Lamed, Yud, whatever it is, right? So we'll do it that way. Okay. Is it? You don't know.
Oh, sorry.
That's okay. Okay. So the boy gets named at the Bris Mila. So we're going to have to wait for the boy to actually have the circumcision before we can actually... So what's up with the circumcision? So the circumcision is a very important mitzvah. First of all, it's called in the Torah, you see Abraham had a circumcision. So before the Torah was even given, okay, Abraham has a circumcision, right? Because he existed before the Torah. So that's a mitzvah that comes very, very early on. All the mitzvahs were given like 1,000 years later or something, you know. He was given at that point. So there's something about this thing which is very, very important in terms of the formation of the Jewish people, right? Because we go back to Abraham as our ancestor, you see. And he had it at a very old age, but over there it says that a baby boy has it at the age of 8 days old, if possible. Okay? If not, you can, for whatever reason, if the baby is jaundice or something else, you can push it off. Okay? Actually, if a baby is born on Shabbat, he should get circumcised on Shabbat. Okay? It should actually go. Oh, because the first day of birth is considered the first day of the eight. See? So it's Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, again, it's the eighth day. Okay, so I want to talk about the number 8 in a couple of moments. There's a lot to say on Bris Mila. We don't have too much time for too much. I'll give you the main thing. So the Bris Mila is actually called an os, a sign. It's referred to as a sign, an S-I-G-N. In Hebrew, an os or an oat. Yeah. So to mal is the actual circumcision itself. The word Bris actually means a covenant. And is used actually... in a number of occasions, not referring to circumcision. So the mila is the actual cutting itself of the foreskin, but the word bris is a covenant, it's a connection, right, between the Jewish people and God. Okay, so in other words, many times covenants were made between covenants generally mean, I think it's a word, connections or commitments that will last for eternity. It's a very, very strong bond and promise. So when Abraham was told to have a circumcision, that means there was some connection that was going to go all the way down through his descendants, would always be there. Okay? That's hinted at in another way, which is an os, a sign. See? Now, the mitzvah of Mila is called a sign. Actually, tefillin, you know, the phylacteries that men put on, is called a sign, as well as Shabbat. Shabbat is also called a sign. So what's a sign? So what do signs do? Well, they direct us, right? They tell us to slow down, right? They show us where to go, they show us why to go. And they also identify what's happening. So for example, if I turn up at a store and it says Ellie's Bagels. There's two things I know about the place. One, there's a guy inside. His name is probably Ellie. And two, they sell bagels. Right? Let's say I turn up one day, and I see the doors are closed. They're locked. The lights are off, and all the chairs are on the table. What do I know about Ellie's Bagels?
They're closed.
It's closed. Let's say I turn up a day later, okay, and the lights are off, and the doors are locked, and the chairs are up on the table. But this time the sign has been taken down. What do I know? They're out of business, you see. Okay, let's say clean behind the sign outside of Pesach, but you know basically they're out of business, you see. So the Jewish people have a sign as a nation, which shows we're in business. And that sign has three things written on it. Shabbat, Tefillin, and Bris Milah. Which means if any one of these three is removed from our people, we're no longer a people. Which means that since we were told by God that we would always be a nation, unlike all the other nations that have gone, the Romans and the Greeks, the Babylonians all disappeared, right? We are still here. Which means this mitzvah would always exist right through Jewish history. Now, you may be thinking, but aren't all the mitzvah there? And the answer is no. Many disappeared. The entire temple is gone. Temple of Jerusalem, which knocked out a few hundred, right? As well as that, there's other mitzvah which are related to the temple, which only performed that temple times. So there's many mitzvahs that don't exist. Today, we only have about 270, and on a regular basis, 30 or 40. Okay, but these three have to exist, because they define who we are. Okay, and this mitzvah as well. It's actually counterintuitive. All the things that we've kept on doing, and the things that we've stopped doing, you would have thought, taking an eight-day-old baby, against its will, right, and cutting off a piece of its skin in that particular area, and why that area is chosen, we'll see in a second. Could have been a pierced ear, right? There's a reason why that particular part of the baby was chosen. There's no coincidence, okay? But there's something specific about that mitzvah that without it, we're no longer the Jewish people. That even people who don't connect in any other way to Judaism will still perform that one thing. And actually, it's a mitzvah, not for the baby, because 80-year-old babies don't ask for circumcisions. It's a mitzvah for the parents to bring the baby. As a side point, let's say parents decide not to, which unfortunately now, I won't say the first time in Jewish history, because it happened in the time of the Greeks as well, but many people are preferring not to do a circumcision, and they let them cut a carrot or something else, okay, which is a great shame, by the way, okay, because it's really a very strong part of Jewish identity, right? But let's say parents decide not to give their kids a bris milah. They were to say that. What happens? So when the child hits 13, the obligation falls on him. It's an interesting thing. Actually transfers, which, trust me, is unusual. You have transferal of, okay. And if you look at the former Soviet Union, you see many, many boys who came from families where it was actually outlawed and didn't circumcise and were circumcised by their parents because they weren't allowed to. It was outlawed. So what exactly did they do? When they got older, they actually volunteered. There's actually a guy who was involved in the JC, came from a certain country in Eastern Europe, and he found out he was Jewish at 16. And it's a very close friend of mine, and he wasn't circumcised. And he told me, and I said, well, you probably should get circumcised. So, fortunately, when you get older, you get full anesthetic, obviously. But actually, the recovery is still painful, you know. So he, you know, I didn't think about it. And then he decided, okay, so I'll go for the circumcision, you know. Perfect timing, by the way. We have the one male come in. So he goes, I'll go for the circumcision. So he had the circumcision, which, you know, as I said, was anesthetized. But afterwards, it's a very big mitzvah. And there's many, many Russian boys who came through the floor and who came and decided, went to Israel, and then they decided to have a circumcision. So every time I go to a bris milah and he's there and the baby starts crying, he always says, I know what that baby's going through. None of you know what that baby's going through, but I know what that baby is going through. I want to talk for a moment about the number 8, and then we'll talk about, well, women are not circumcised, okay? It may seem obvious too, because we don't have a particular organ. So it could have been something else. Could have taken a bit out of the ear or something, you know, or taken a bit out of the nose, which many do anyway. But so what was the, so what exactly is the reason behind that? Well, first of all, let's talk about the number 8. So the number eight actually has a lot of interest that goes with it. Well, to know that what the number eight is about, we've got to talk about the number seven. Because you want to get eight, look at seven. So what's number seven represent? So the number seven represents this world. Okay? There's 7 days of the week. You go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and back to one again. Okay? So seven is this world. There are seven notes in musical scale. Okay? It just isn't an eighth note. It doesn't exist. It goes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, then back to one. Da, 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 da. That's just the way it goes. That's the scale. That's the way they exist. You can't change that. Okay? The seven colors of a rainbow. So seven is always this world. So if I get to the number eight, I am above this world. Can you see that? What we call in Hebrew, lamalam and atever, above the natural order. So the number eight always represents the miraculous. So for example, there are 8 days of Hanukkah. Okay, and Hanukkah, of course, is the famous open miracle that the oil lasts. So the number eight is discussed a lot when you talk about Hanukkah because it's taking you above the physical into the miraculous, metaphysical, spiritual world whilst exists in this world. See? So the number eight is always, which is why it can't be coincidence that the figure eight, although the Jews did not create that figure, by the way, right, that thing, but it happens to be, that's infinity, isn't it? Oh, yeah. It just happens to be, right? So
it's right here, actually.
Oh, it is? Oh, nice name.
Prospect.
Oh, very good.
My company
logo. Oh, very good. So that's the number. You came the right evening. Right, so the number eight always represents the infinite, okay? The Jews did not make, I'm not saying, right, that the Jews made that figure, but the concept of eightness, being lamala melateva, above the physical, into the spiritual world, is a very Jewish idea, right? The eighth day of Sukkot, Shemini Atzeret, that's a very special metaphysical day. And of course, the baby's brought to Bris Mila on the eighth as well, on the eighth day, because you're taking that baby and saying, this baby's going to live a life that is above the physical. Right, we're trying to create this metaphysical reality, right? That is the child. So the question is then, why do women not get a circumcision or something else, right? Female circumcision obviously is not even a consideration, but why don't women do something else to represent that? So one answer you could say is because really it's the parents' mitzvah. Together as a team, they bring their child on the eighth day, right? Because it's not the baby per se, but the Gemara says. A woman is considered as if she is circumcised. She doesn't need to do anything else. Wait, why would that be? So there is actually, we said this before, it's women are considered as though they've been through the circumcision because her, and I'll quote a Rav Tzadok, which is a very famous commentator, for even her flesh is considered holy. That is how women are seen in Jewish thought. They don't need it. Men need it. Men need it, particularly in that area. Because they have to know that through that comes life, and that is an area that needs to be worked on. And there's a famous, I think it's a Midrash, maybe a Talmud, but definitely a Midrash, a famous one, of a great sage by the name of Rabbi Akiva. And Rabbi Akiva was having a discussion with Turnus Rufus, who was one of the Romans, an evil individual, by the way, who caused a lot of tragedy among the Jewish people. And they would have discussions. And Turnus Rufus turned around to Rabbi Akiva and said to him, whose actions are better, God or man? Right. So, Rabbi Akiva asked that. Turnus Rufus responded and said, well, you know, it's obvious, really. God's greater, you know. So Rabbi Akiva said, why? He goes, because God created heaven and earth, didn't he? So Rabbi Akiva said, well, that's true, but use an example that, you know, humans are involved in. So Rabbi Akiva brought out a beautiful cake, right? Or a nice loaf of bread, whatever you want to say. And brought out a handful of wheat and said, what's better, the wheat or the cake? So it turns out we'd have to say, the cake's better. And why? God made the wheat, right? And we made the cake. Rabbi Akiva said, exactly. We take the raw material and we work at it and improve it. That is the position of mankind. We take the raw material of this world and we rework it and elevate it for a higher use. Okay? That can be used for many ideas, but specifically with circumcision, which is why I think the context of that conversation was, because the Romans were against that, based upon the Greek ideas, you have to leave the body, it's perfect, and we don't. And the idea being that we take this raw material and we want to improve it. And that particular area of the baby is chosen specifically because every Jewish male must realize that through this, there is a holier purpose that goes with us. It was chosen as the place of the covenant. Right. Now, I'll tell you something unusual about this. Now, excuse the expression. It's going to sound weird to you. But the circumcision is actually like a passport. Okay? Now, no one ever says that. I'm the only person who says that. So don't freak out. What I mean by that, there seems to be a connection between moral sexual behavior, which remember is where the circumcision is placed, and that's one of the points, and the land of Israel. Before Abraham could go to Israel, he had the circumcision first. See? So that seemed to be his passport in. It's connected. Now, if you look at the Torah, it doesn't seem it. He has the circumcision, then he goes to Israel. But we're saying, actually, those two events are related. And the land, I'm throwing in the land of Israel now over here. The land of Israel, says the Torah, is a very spiritual land. The land itself. And in order to have it, you have to earn it. And I don't even mean Jews, by the way. Whoever is occupying it has to earn it. And there's one thing that doesn't sit well in the land of Israel, and that's sexual promiscuity. Okay, specifically the breakdown of the family. The land of Israel, it may sound unusual to you, I'm just telling you what the commentators say. Don't shoot the messenger. The land of Israel is like a sensitive stomach. You put in the wrong food, it ejects it. Actually, the word in the Torah, right, for this thing is actually vomits it out. Yokio Shvea, it literally vomits out people. That's the land of Israel. It has a spiritual essence that it can't tolerate anything so like it. And that's Rashi. Rashi says, like a sensitive stomach. And you'll notice that many different peoples have been in that land, and they've gone and they've conquered out in. And I got in history class by Israel, and it's like unbelievable. New nations. This is actually the spiritual source that goes behind it. This particular area. Happens to be that certain nations that occupy parts of Israel right now were also given circumcision. And actually do fulfill it, although they're not commanded to. They do actually do circumcision, and they actually get the merit of being on certain parts of the land itself. I know it sounds a little unusual to you, but just you see that with this mitzvah, it identifies the child. It identifies them as a sign among the people. It's a mitzvah the parents bring them forward into, but actually connects us even to the land of Israel.
Okay? Why are the parents deciding now to stop doing it?
I don't know if this should be videoed, this part, but I may edit it out afterwards. we've reached this... I'm just saying, I can't... It's hard for me to PC all the time. Well, truth is, we've entered a very sad time in Jewish history, I should say. It's a very exciting time, but it has challenges, I should say. It's a nice way to put it. That, for some reason, they see it as a barbaric act. Who are we to make a decision for a child? That kind of thinking comes out. I think we have to ask people to do it. There's actually a number of movies recently about certain people who are like fighting with the idea. If you want my personal opinion, it's part of that kind of mindset. Who are we to make a decision to impose? We don't impose religion on anyone else, even our own kids. I can't even have opinions about, you know, religion and to spread around children, you know. But the root of it is the disconnect of some people towards their Jewish faith. And it's a big thing to do. I'm not belittling it. Like, bring your child, so when you actually have a baby, an eight-day-old, and it's a little tiny thing, you know, bring, I mean, I did it, and I was going to do it. But, you know, my wife said to me, I'll tell the truth, she's like, part of me wants to take the baby and run, you see. it's a big myth, so I'm not, you know, I hear it, but we've always done it. We've always done it. But it's a big commitment. You're actually making a statement, you see. It's not just about the, you know, the baby and the operation, and but you're making a statement that I'm part of the Jewish people. You know, I look different. And that's a very big thing for some people to say. And they just can't handle it, you know. There's also a lot of misinformation. Not a lot. There's some misinformation about, you know, it's painful for the child and it's dangerous, which just isn't true. If it's done properly with a proper moel and these people are trained, it shouldn't be like that at all, you know. So it's part of the... Unfortunately, people don't want to face up to their responsibility as Jews, to be perfectly honest with you. And because we live in this liberal world now, where who are we to impose anything upon anybody else? Many, many people do. Many, many people do.
I think like in hospitals, they offer it.
Yeah. Yeah, many people do.
I think it comes from female genital mutilation and people reacting to that and then feeling like, well, if it's barbaric and it's a social issue that it's happening in other countries to women, then we should be.
Right. So, but with a bit of education we've had today, we see the two are completely disconnected. I mean, the royal family actually all the males in the royal family in England actually are circumcised by Moel, actually.
Yeah. Really?
Sure.
Really?
Yeah. Dr. Moel, yeah.
Why do they do that?
Wannabes. I think that they are. I really don't think they are. Okay. They say that there was a big backlash against it, coming from the Jewish world, of course. But the AMA, is that what it's called in this country?
Yeah.
They actually have a paper, which I have, which goes through that and actually proves that there are a lot of health benefits. But there's a lot of fighting right now, unfortunately, inside the Jewish world and different factions that are against it, you know. I mean, when our hater referred to as a barbaric act, it's very upsetting, you know. But it's a great shame. Great shame. Any other questions? Anything we discussed tonight? We covered a lot of stuff.
I thought I had to step out with the naming part. Can you just read the review that you were talking about, the naming in terms of...
We just said, to review it, which is probably good for everyone else, naming a child with a Hebrew name is a gives them identity. Parents are given prophecy at that moment, some say Ruach HaKodesh, to name their child. It defines their essence. You have to choose carefully what name you choose, and you should actually go to someone to ask them whether that's a good name, which is very common. People will go and ask their rabbi if this is a good name to use.
You're supposed to name the person, the child after, you know, suppose like you were saying the grandparent or something. Mm-hmm. In the event, because I've heard this happen a couple of times, the person may not have been such a nice person.
Very good question. Excellent question. Great question.
You don't want your child
so, that very, very good. So there's a difference. It's quite technical, but it works. There's a difference between naming after that person and using their name. So in the event where you don't name after a very nasty person, which could be, some people's grandparents are just not nice, or some other relative, someone who died young, okay? They'll do is they'll take that name and then use another name, and you're not naming after that person, you're just using their names. And many people do that.
So like two names.
Yeah, you're double-barreled. All my kids are double-barreled. Yeah, both could be of choice. Both could be of choice.
Yeah.
It comes like a second name. Like a middle. Well, it's not middle. It's just that becomes your name.
Right?
Like you have a Hebrew name?
Yeah.
What's your Hebrew name?
But
yeah. Rachel. Oh, Rachel. Okay. That's a good point. I don't think about that.
No,
yeah.
It's not Rachel.
Yeah. I have a Rachel.
Yeah.
I have a Rachel. Yeah. You have a Hebrew name? Just mention.
Yeah.
Eliza. Very nice.
Leia.
Mm-hmm. So it's a winner. Yes.
No, it's
mine. Oh, it's Leia, right?
Chana.
That's my wife's name. Well, her first name, yeah. Do you have any Hebrew name? If you don't,
my name is in Hebrew, so
Ephrat. Ephrat?
Yeah, I go by
Ephrat. Nice. You should go by Ephrat. Lovely name. Yeah, you have any Hebrew name?
Daniela.
Mine's Vega, but it's not really Hebrew.
Very good question. If that was a question. actually,
that's, what they told me when
that's
I was
your
Hebrew,
name.
So.
That's your name. It's actually Yiddish. It means a
bird, right?
Bird, right. As a bird. Actually, the lady teaching next door is a fee.
Right.
Yeah. My wife's second name is actually a Yiddish name. So that actually is a Hebrew name. That will be used, and that's considered to be a... Yeah, it absolutely does. Hebrew name? Maya. I think you know that one, right?
My cousin's name is... My grandfather passed away before my cousin and I were born, and his name is Shalom, and my cousin's name is Avi Shalom.
Oh, by the way, just a side point over here. You can name a... it's a little technical again. You can name a girl after a guy and change the name. Sometimes they change the name, that kind of thing. They change the name like a male name, like a female. You should try not to take a female name and... Oh, sorry. You can take a female name and masculinize it, make it a male name. But taking a male name and making it female, that's quite common. They suggest against...
Daniel to Daniela.
It's not... I know many people. My sister-in-law is like that. I know many people like that as well. It's fine. It's not a law. It's just they say that. But it's fine. If it's done, it's done. It's a fine name. It's actually a different name. Was a good person?
I was a good person.
Then you are as well. I feel good.
Right.
I feel good. But people do that, and it works out, by the way, for you to do it, and people will actually change the names. The English name is not... I did meet a Kabbalist once. I may have to delete this from the video. who I go by my English name because I have an unusual Hebrew name. So when I use it, it's a little unusual for people. So I go by Lawrence, which is my first name. I realize that. I don't use my last name because I sound like a terrorist, but which is hard to go through airport security anyway, as it is, right? So anyway, but the English name, I say, actually, it could have some influence. I'll give you an example. I know a lady. I have to give you the name because you know, I went to the last name, whose name is Frida. She went to a rabbi at some point in her life, and he said, "You've got to change your name. Change your name." And she was an older lady. I said, "Why?" Because he goes, "The word Frida, maybe it's only in her case. So don't think it applies to every Frida. It comes from the word leparit, which is separate." And she's actually divorced 3 times.
Wow.
I just thought. There is also a custom when people are very, very sick to change their name. It's very common. They have to be very, like, deathly ill. So, for example, for a man, they'll have the name Chaim, which means life, or Raphael, which means healing. Right? He's the angel of healing, Raphael. And for a woman, they add Chaya, for example, something like that, you know, life as well. When they're very, very sickly, very, very ill. And this is based upon the same idea that when I change the name, I'm changing the person. In other words, Ralph is ill. I'll use like a generic name. Ralph is ill, but Ralph Chaim is someone different. So what you're really doing is actually changing the name. So the Rambam says, actually, before Yom Kippur, which is hard to believe, people used to get so upset about all their things they've done the entire year, they're actually changing the names to say, "I'm a different person."
Every year.
I don't know how to do it. By the end of the life, I've got 70 names. It's like God. Like 70 names, you know what I'm saying? It's like a whole big thing. But this is the...
What do you have to do to change your name?
Very, very good. So you have to be known by it. Many times they'll make an announcement in synagogue. It's very common, by the way, unfortunately. They'll change the name in synagogue. Someone will go up and say, "We're changing the name on behalf of this person." The person himself will do it. Or they get known by that name. And that becomes their name. It's a big thing, by the way. It's not a small thing to do. We don't mess around with stuff. Really, names are... It's almost like the barcode. I mean, just like a barcode is a series of lines. But if you put it over the red line at the supermarket, it comes up on the screen with the information, blip, and it comes up. So your name has the same power. So there are actually people you can meet that have messaged people that can look at you, read your name, and tell you about yourself. Actually, they say you can't be a Hasidic, right? You can't be a Hasidic. I heard it from one of my rabbis who was Hasidic. He said, "You're not even considered to be a Hasidic Rebbe. That's the least, unless you're able to read a Kvittel. Kvittel is all the names of the family and understand it." And I've met certain people, and there's many charlatans out there, many people who I've met, and they'll take the name. And when you pray for a person, you pray for them with their name. But the Hebrew name is the best way, with the mother's name. My wife says, the way to remember it, my wife says, is when you're sick, you go to your mother. Right, so you go with your father, you're sick, you go to the mother. That's where I remember it. That's my wife's little addition over there. I've been to these, and they'll literally talk and tell you about yourself. Like, how do they know that, you see? And there are people who have such abilities. But the name is the access point, interesting enough.
Were you saying before that to name after is supposed to be the exact same name of the person? Because when I said mine, you said it's a different name.
Your name of that person is actually a different name.
So when you name after, it should be the same.
Well, that's when you name. That's when you're naming. It doesn't have to be. I'm saying people will change. They'll take a variation of the name. You actually weren't really named after that person. I mean, you can say you were. It doesn't make a difference. But technically, right. you've just used that name.
Because they changed it. Because it was changed.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, it's changed. My Hebrew name is Mashiach. Well, yeah, it's a new, in the Jewish world, you have to trust me, tell people who are involved it's an unusual name to have. Yeah. Right? It's got a nice name. It's my grandfather's name, actually. Actually, my grandfather had many grandchildren. They couldn't find... no one was named. They were, no one was naming after him. So I think my parents actually had a baby just... You know. But I'll tell you something else. I have no evidence on this, but it's something I've seen. This is anecdotal. Is that the right word? Well, it is now. But I've seen that sometimes... When you go through naming your child, that person passes away. Have you seen this thing? Or you go through a simcha, a great celebration, a new life comes to the world, someone in the family actually passes away. Have you seen this before? Right before, right around wedding time, soon after weddings, or births. Have you seen this before? That's anecdotal, but I've seen it. It seems like the new generation is coming in, you know? I feel like it's going to take me over from the... It is a custom for me not to go. I think... It could be some deeper reason. I think the basic reason is because she may get very upset, and we don't want to put her.
And it's not healthy for the baby to have a stressful mother with the hormones.
I believe that's one of the reasons. As some say, it's not good for the mazal, right, of the woman. By the way, just I want to mention that word as well. Just I'll maybe finish off. This is a nice idea. The word mazal. Many people define it as luck. We say mazal tov when a baby's born, and we name the baby, and the bris mila. So the word mazal does not mean luck. Luck is not a Jewish concept. Everything happens for a reason. Okay? And it's actually very offensive, think about it. Oh, you're getting married. Good luck with that. Mazal tov. Oh, you had twins? Good luck with that. You know? So that's obviously very offensive. So the word mazal, actually, different interpretations I've heard. One comes from the word nizl, which means to flow. Things should flow well for you. They flow well. Yeah, they go through not too many bumps along the way. Another interpretation, I had a whole class on this once, is actually from mazalot. It means the stars should be aligned astronomically and astrologically in the right formations, that this baby or this wedding should happen at the right time. Okay. By the way, you don't say, I still cringe when I hear this, when a woman is pregnant, you're not meant to say mazal tov. You aware of this? Yeah. You shouldn't say mazal tov. You actually meant to say b'sha'a tova, which literally means at a good time. Relates to this idea. She'll be born at the right time. Okay, which means physically, not too early and not too late, although they don't go too late anyway, right? But it should be b'sha'a tova at the right time. See, and when the baby's born, then you say mazal tov.
And in terms of not naming a baby after a person who hasn't had a full life, how is like a full life?
People who were killed young, I know this was a question, but people who will die as young children, or people in Holocaust. So they use the names, but I listen. People do name after these people because they're considered very holy, right? They've killed, Al Kiddush Hashem, a sanctification of God's name, but they may add another name if they had a very early demise, usually through disease, actually. They add a name on. I've seen that happen a lot. Right? Great question. They choose a name. Yeah, that becomes their name. It's actually part of the process. And many times I've seen people choose names which are uncanny, without me even knowing, uncanny. I have a good friend of mine who converted, and his name was Peter. Not a Jewish name. And he converted. He happens to be very, very good with his hands, always building things. He's a very, very physical person. He builds menorahs and And he chose the name Bezalel, who happened to be the person that, who in the Torah created the tabernacle, the Mishkan, where the ark was kept. He built that, all the menorah and all that. He was involved in that. He didn't actually build the menorah. Moses did. But all the influence was involved in that. So many times the name, you'll see the name they choose actually reflects the person themselves. Who were they the child of? Ben. And they called up the Torah. Their father wasn't Jewish. They go with Avraham. Because we're all sons of Abraham. So they become Ben Avraham, the son of Abraham. So you fill out a ketubah. For a person whose father wasn't Jewish, we put Ben Avraham down on the kazuba. A lot of naming questions. Yeah.
It goes with the baby questions.
Yeah, it does. All right, we'll stop over there.